Greetings to students, faculty, and our viewing audience at home from the campus of Howard University. Welcome to a special episode of At Howard. I'm your host, Minnie Larry. Now, if you've been keeping up with current events, you may have heard the news stories with these names in it. Civilians and officers, Eric Smith, Philando Castile, Ashley Gwendon, Oscar Grant, Michael Brown, and the five police officers killed in Dallas, Texas. These victims and others like them have sparked outrage and debates across the country. Yet, when these accounts are no longer hot topics, the focus of the media and the society at large shifts to the next big story. Now, today, you'll learn about a unique program that extends the conversation beyond a 30-second soundbite. It's called Policing Inside Out. It's a revolutionary college course that picks up where media or public interest stops. Policing Inside Out addresses the disconnect between the community and the police. Through this 15-week curriculum, police and young Black millennials learn and grow together in an effort to foster authentic social change. Now, before I introduce the panel, I'd like to show you a short segment of a documentary produced about the innovative program, Policing Inside Out.
Howard University prides itself on truth and service, and so the mission of the university rests itself on the importance of truth and being of service, not only to the minority community, but to the global world at large. The partnership with IACP was extremely important for myself is because you want to start at the top. One of the things that I've done throughout the history of implementing Inside Out programs is to start with the top organizations, the most highly respected organizations, the organizations that are on the grounds doing the work, implementing the policy, doing the changes, and doing the hard work. And so it was really important for me to be able to reach out to IACP to see how I could be of service as an instructor here at this wonderful mecca of a university to be able to facilitate dialogue between communities of color and chiefs of police.
The partnership with Howard University gives us that academic framework, first of all. It also provides an opportunity to bring folks in through the school, through Howard, into a classroom that's a safe environment where people can open up and talk about the issues that maybe they're not able to talk about at a community level in an environment that isn't as safe as that classroom. And I think that is one of the things that has been most impressive to me.
In this first class, we're gonna break the ice. We're gonna melt it first by doing like introductions and talking about your name, your Howard intro, and then why you were interested in this class. Real honesty, critical, brutally, honestly, why?
The first day of class, I walked in and I saw the police officers, and I never had a rough encounter with a police officer. However, when I walked in, the atmosphere was kind of, I would say, feature a kind of tension. We haven't like established a foundation of trust among police officers and students as a whole. So walking in, we're just sitting in a room full of strangers who, you know, work in a profession that's killing off our young Black men every day.
It's like, hold on, wait. But we're in here because we all care about something.
I say it was difficult on the communication aspect only because we had Caucasian officers in our class and I felt like they didn't really understand what it was like to be a Black male living in society. In my opinion, I don't believe that we're afforded a lot of opportunities based on the stereotypes that are formed against us.
The same experience this officer shared about how parents tell their kids all the time, you go into a restaurant, don't talk to him. If you do something wrong, he's gonna arrest you. We're taking those experiences. They're becoming a part of our mindset, and we ultimately live with that over our lifetime. No different than my dad telling me, don't look at the police. Keep your hands out your pockets. He grew up in the 50s and the 60s, so his experiences have shaped his mindset, particular to the community and particular to policing. So in order for us to have community policing, there has to be a shift in our organizational mindset outside of what our experiences are. Because I dare anybody to walk out of here today, hopefully by the end of the day, just the groundbreaking portion of today, that you'll have a different experience when you're dealing with the mindset of other officers that are in the room and vice versa.
Policing inside out is experiential learning at its best. It allows for an opportunity for a marriage between two conflicting individuals, that being citizens, especially citizens of color, and law enforcement officials. Bringing these individuals together on common grounds to be able to engage over 15 weeks. Inside out and policing allows for the opportunity for conversations, dialogue, and experiences to go from the inside to the outside. There are a lot of things that we hold back. There are a lot of feelings and emotions that are harboring and growing and expanding as a result of the negative images that we see day in and day out on the television news and media.
In the beginning, the police officers in particular were just talking about all the great things that they've done, and you know that all this stuff that's happened in the news is not our fault personally. And then, you know, as we started to open up to each other, and then, you know, talk about some more serious things, and then each side listening starts to build trust, validating each other's concern. And once someone's concern has been validated, they're not going to be on the defensive to the same degree. And that's where you can start to solve these problems and start moving ahead.
Now that we've gotten you excited about this new program, we're going to meet our panelists. Dr. Bahiyyah Muhammad is the founding director of the Policing Inside Out program at Howard University. Dr. Muhammad is a professor of criminology in the Department of Sociology and Criminology. Her classes have been dubbed the Dr. Muhammad Experience and have won her the title of Professor of the Year for 2014 and 15. We also have Ms. Aaliyah Lewis. She is a graduating senior seeking a bachelor's degree in public relations with a minor in sociology. She's currently serving as a communications intern for the DC Charter School Board. And now we have Mr. Cameron Clark. Mr. Clark is a senior biology and health education community health double major. He's currently working as a health policy focused intern in Senator Cory Booker's office and as the health and wellness liaison for the DC Superintendent of Education. We also have Sergeant Doug Gibson. He's been with the Baltimore Police Department for more than 23 years. He's currently assigned to the Community Collaboration Division for the Southeastern District of Baltimore. We also have Sergeant Dan Helton. He's a member of the Montgomery Police Department Community Engagement Division. Deputy Commissioner Daryl D'Souza has served the Baltimore Police Department for more than 28 years. He was appointed Deputy Police Commissioner in August of 2015 after previously serving as the Chief of Patrol Division. Lieutenant Tarek McGuire is a member of the Arlington, Texas Police Department. He is currently assigned as a Law Enforcement Fellow with the International Association of Chiefs of Police, where he's assisted in the development of IACP's Institute for Community Police Relations. And now I'm going to give you over to the Lady of the Hour, Dr. Muhammad.
Thank you all so much for coming out today, and we're very excited to have this engaging conversation. And really, we're just going to jump right into the conversation. You guys have seen the video. On the panel today, we have students who participated in the inaugural class, as well as some students who have participated in the second segment, which allows us to kind of roundabout in one full year of Policing Inside Out. Can you please just share with the audience what brought you to the class? What brought you to Policing Inside Out? And I'll start with you, Aaliyah.
The class for me kind of happened by chance. I didn't necessarily sign up for it. So when I realized what the class was, I was, you know, very happy to be there. But I think I mostly stayed because I realized that this is something that I'm very passionate about, and I and I want my children to grow up and have better relationships with police officers, so it has to start with me.
Now, growing up, what was your relationship like with law enforcement?
I didn't have a relationship with law enforcement, and I was taught not to have a relationship with law enforcement. My parents always just kind of told me to stay out of the way, don't interact, just, you know, do what you're supposed to do and keep pushing.
Okay.
Well, I think when the Baltimore Police Department was invited to participate, one of my lieutenants at the time was tasked with selecting someone, and I had worked with him for many, many years, and he knew my reputation for always looking for new and better ways to improve relations with the community. So he called me up on relatively short notice and asked me to participate in the class, but I think he knew what my answer was going to be before he even dialed the phone. So that's how I ended up here.
Okay. Cameron, what about you?
I originally came to the Inside Out course. I thought it was going to be because there are multiple different experiences. There's the juvenile justice, there's the mass incarceration, and there's the policing. I thought I was signing up for the mass incarceration course. So when I got in the first day and you told us that we were going to be dealing with police officers for 15 weeks, I was originally like, I don't know about that. But I think when I thought about it, I realized that we didn't really have as much engagement with police officers as an HBCU as maybe we should have. Because when we're dealing with these issues of violence and policing and reform, we don't really have the voice of the police department, so we're not able to advocate for real policy changes. So that's why I ended up staying in the course.
Okay. Was there something that specific that happened that kind of gave you kind of that standoff approach?
I think it's just I wouldn't say I've never had a positive relationship with police or law enforcement. It's just that the relationship has really been non-existent for most of my life. So aside from a few stops and frisks and random searches, it's really just been there's been a distance between me and police officers. So when I was given the opportunity to take the class initially, there was a little bit of hesitancy, but because this is such an important topic, that's why I chose to stay.
Okay. Dan, Helton.
So I was also given very short notice, but this is something that we were actually looking for. It's one of those things that kind of fell in our lap where we've been doing some new engagement efforts with our department with different community groups. But one of the things we were missing was the younger generation, that whole segment of, you know, 18 to 30 or 35. And getting their feedback and getting their input. What do they want to hear from the police department? What can we hear from them? The dialogue, just having that line of communication. We didn't have it. We didn't have their perspective either, and which I think is obviously key. So once I saw the syllabus, I was a little intimidated at first, but you know, definitely a great opportunity. So you know, I jumped on it and had some other officers come too, and it's been really good. Definitely something that we needed.
We also have in our audience in the front row dignitaries from the IACP, specifically two IACP fellows, Deputy Commissioner D'Souza and Lieutenant Tarek McGuire. Can you please also share with the audience how you were brought into the class? We know that with the IACP, you guys are dealing with a lot of different programming and things that are happening at the IACP. Can you please share, and I'll start with you, Lieutenant McGuire, on what helped you to navigate towards shepherding in leadership, a leadership role in the creation and expansion and involvement with Policing Inside Out with Howard University?
Sure, so there's no secret to the challenges that law enforcement have been facing across the country. Some of the issues that we've had in Arlington, Texas have really mirrored some situations that have occurred in Baltimore, Maryland. And so I believe that this was a great opportunity for us to partner with the HBCU, which has not been done historically at IACP. But it also allowed us from a research component to look at the gaps that we kind of saw in probably one of the most valuable documents of this policing age, which was the President's Task Force on 21st Century Policing. It was an opportunity to hear the voice of young millennials, African-American millennials. And so for us, It was an excellent opportunity to really not only engage youth, but to understand a different perspective. And so law enforcement agencies across the country are really seeking to build trust in communities of color. And this really created an avenue for the entire organization of the law enforcement community to take a deeper dive into that knowledge and information. So me being here with an opportunity as a law enforcement fellow to be a part of this national research initiative has been an excellent opportunity to not only make new friends, but to really understand a communal perspective.
Okay, thank you.
And Dr. Muhammad, I have to thank you and thank Lieutenant McGuire, because I remember the first time that you guys had met inside the IACP conference room, and Lieutenant McGuire invited me into the room. And when he and you were explaining the program, I said, wow, I said, this is Baltimore. This has Baltimore written all over it. And I think that the things that we're facing today in society, I think that our millennials are looking at things, and although they might be 18, 19, all the way up to 34 years old, they still look at things in a historical lens versus law enforcement like we have to do here and now. And our look is more contemporary. And we realize that there were torn relationships in the past, and we realize the things that we had in Baltimore and across the country, that we had to repair that. And that repair has to come even beyond wearing that uniform, that our relationships have to be greater than that. So we took the opportunity when it presented itself with the IACP saying, will Baltimore participate? Howard University and yourself saying, will Baltimore City Police Department participate? And it's great. And it's why not? And it's like the panel said, you know, we don't want to be that stranger. We don't want to be that guy. You know, we don't want to be by a last name. You know, we want to be known as a Dan or a Doug or a Tarek or a Daryl. And that's the type of relationships that we like to see in the city and across the country.
Thank you. Throughout the semester, for the 15 weeks, we basically had kind of pillars, so to speak. And one of the most important foundational pillar was communication. I would love to hear from you guys outside of, you know, grades are in now. We've done our final presentations. We have individuals who participated last semester and have gone out to continue to do the amazing work, you know, that you do. How and why is communication important?
Sure, I'll do it. I think that it's impossible to have any productive discussion about change if you're not having a discussion in the first place. I've participated in Black Lives Matter protests. I've gone to various events dealing with police brutality, police reform. But when you miss out on the voice of the officers involved, then you really have a fractured view of what the situation is. So myself, I'm interested in long-term reform. I'm interested in systemic societal reforms of the relationships between police officers and communities. And in order to achieve that, we can't create those reforms if we're not taking the initiative to reach out to police and to see what their issues are with communities, with reaching out to the communities that they serve. Because until we do that, we're gonna have one unwilling partner. And when you have an unwilling partner, you're not gonna achieve anything that's gonna last more than a generation.
Sergeant Helton, what about you? I know that you do a lot of work as it relates to community engagement and, you know, building trust. How important is communication to you outside of, you know, all of the work that you're doing personally and professionally?
I think the biggest thing is you can't, in order to find out where the other people are coming from, what's going on in their perspective, you know, what do they need from us? You need to be able to communicate. If we think there's a problem in a neighborhood, we can't just say, all right, we're going to do this and just bring it to the neighborhood and that's going to be the fix. You need to be able to, you know, have community members and people from the neighborhoods, what have you, work together to have, you know, create a solution to a problem. And that can't happen unless you got some communication. And whether it's short term or long term, to be able to know where you know, why people think a certain way or why they view the police a certain way. You have to know your audience before you're going to come in and try to talk to them. And So that's why I think it's definitely very important.
Mm-hmm. Aaliyah, in the Department of Sociology and Criminology, you know, it's all about communication. It's all about socializing and looking at social problems, criminological issues and concerns. With this being an area of specialization for you, how has this class helped you to shape your future trajectory as it relates to communication? Do you think it's going to be something easier for you to engage possibly with law enforcement officials to be able to raise those children that you talk about where there's not an ingrown distrust of law enforcement?
I think this class has definitely helped me, and it's going to help me be able to teach my children to interact with police. But I will still say that, like, it didn't just clear everything. It doesn't make me feel super comfortable around police officers. I still feel a little uncomfortable, but it has helped me be able to have conversations with police officers like I've never had before. I'm able to stay after class and talk about my personal life with some of the officers, and that's very big for me, you know, being somebody who grew up and was taught not to even, you know, say hello to the police officers. So I think that this class has definitely shaped me and helped me be able to communicate with police officers, but it also lit a passion in me. So, yeah.
We want to hear a little bit more about that passion. What are you talking about?
Social injustice is so big for me. It's really heartbreaking to watch the news and see, you know, unarmed Black people being killed by the police on television. And I think this class has, one, helped me be able to control my emotions a little bit and be able to communicate with police officers how I feel about certain situations.
Mm-hmm. Sergeant Gibson, what about you?
Well, I think that the communication is the vessel that we need, the main mechanism to move forward. You know, historically, police departments, you know, not in the too far past, didn't really look to the communities at all for any kind of input or engagement. The police department kind of just said, you know, we got this. We know what you need. Then, you know, as we started to progress a little bit, we decided to seek some community input years ago, and we put a lot of time into seeking community input. We took that information in, but then we still kind of came back and said, yeah, we hear you, but, you know, we got this. We know what's better for you. We got this. And, you know, now I think that police departments across the country are really trying to engage the community and really listen to the input they have. And it's essential that the communities and law enforcement work together to develop policies, develop strategies to deal with crime in their neighborhoods and move forward as a unit more than operating independently as we have.
Now, in the first semester, we actually engaged in a lot of just communication. I mean, that first class, there was a lot of intense kind of emotions. You know, the students come in from campus and the law enforcement officers come in full uniform. And for some of the students who participated in the class, that was one of the main issues that they wanted to kind of get over, this idea of this fear that had been instilled in them intergenerationally. And so you could only imagine the intensity kind of that class coming in, but that's an important thing. It's important to be able to humanize on both sides. Second semester, we kind of learned from some of the things that we did and incorporated what we called the buddy system. And the buddy system meant that you had a student and you had an officer that got together and went on excursions together, had conversations together outside of the actual classroom experience. Cameron and Aaliyah, can you share a bit about your buddy and that buddy system, either as it relates to the final presentation or the excursion to the National Museum of African American History and Culture, or the combination of the two?
For me, the buddy system, it helped me because you were kind of put in a situation to talk to police officers that you don't usually talk to. So in the class, there are these police officers, and you kind of make your friends like any class. And my buddy was always somebody that I hadn't talked to before, somebody that I didn't usually talk to. So it was very helpful for me to kind of get more of a perspective from other police officers that maybe didn't have similarities, you know, that weren't similar to me, I should say.
Okay. So have you ever talked on the phone with an officer before or sent a text message or worked on like a project over a period of time with a law enforcement officer?
Prior to this class, no. Never.
Okay. What about you, Cameron?
I think it was probably the same experience for me. My buddy was actually switched during the middle of the semester, but my buddy was a sheriff for the Baltimore Police Department, or a sheriff of the city of Baltimore. And initially it was, because we were both pretty reserved people, it was sort of hard for us to reach out and make that initial connection. But once we started communicating for the final presentation, we realized not just how much we had in common just as people, but how much we had in common, like you said, intergenerationally. So I found out how many similarities that I actually saw in her that I could identify within my own mom. So it was the building of that sort of relationship across generations, and we realized that it wasn't necessarily so much the uniform or my identity as a student that really separated us, but it was really just because we were born generations apart, that was the source of most of our differences. And once we were able to sort of get over that, then we were able to have really, really deep and productive discussions about like what it means to decide to become a police officer, or what it means to decide that you can identify with a police department and you want to instead be involved in changing or reforming it. And we both realized that we had like a passion for education. We had a passion for justice. We had really the same passions for the same sorts of things, and it was just the way that we expressed those desires to advocate that was different.
Interesting. We're going to take a break in the discussion to show you the kind of impact Inside Out program has had on participants, and I believe a few of them are actually members featured on the panel. We put a few questions to several members of the group to get a better sense of their experience during the course. Here's what a few of them had to say.
My experience in the Inside Out program, I would have to say, has been life-changing, definitely eye-opening as well. I got a chance to see a different side of officers that I probably would have never gotten to see just doing one-on-one interactions off the street or passing them by in the mall or anything like that. And I just got to actually view them as humans outside of being officers. So definitely a life-changing experience.
My experience with the Inside Out program has been an eye-opener. I was a little nervous when I first got invited because I knew I was going to get put out of my comfort zone a little bit. But it's been very rewarding. A lot of issues have been going on with policing in the United States, a lot of which are national issues, which, you know, our 1,000-man department, you know, we can't get ahead of some of these issues. But what we can do is have a dialogue, especially with different perspectives, which the students here really bring, which is great.
It opened my eyes to the way that, you know, young people communicate with officers. It gave me a different way of thinking when it comes to how they should feel as far as police actions and interactions and things like that. And it motivated me to just do a little self-reflecting and looking at how I communicate when I'm speaking with someone, regardless of, you know, their age.
I grew up where we were taught not to speak to police officers. We never called them for anything. So this experience for me has been different because it allows me to not only talk to them about what's going on, but even talk to them about my personal life.
So we'll jump right back into talking about kind of that buddy system and those excursions. Sergeant Helton, can you share with us what your experience was like?
Experience was great. When you said, we're going to go to the museum and you're going to pick your buddy out of the hat, the students pick the officer's name out of the hat, and you all got to figure it out. How are you going to get there? How are you going to meet up? What are you going to do? And I was like, all right, here we go. So
I got my buddy and we were coordinating how we're gonna get down there. And I was like, well, here's my cell phone number. And they're like, I can have your number? I said, yeah. So we texted each other, we met up at Howard, met up at Starbucks, got a cup, took an Uber, went over there, and went to the museum together, which was great. That was I've been trying to get into the museum for a while, but it's hard with, you know, to take tickets. So I was really fortunate to deal with this class. Go to the museum, we see as much as we can. I mean, we tried to get it to every floor, but it's just so much. But we did make sure we ate lunch. Hmm. And you can't miss that. So where, you know, the lunch was great. I mean, it was really good. And then on the way back, another student gave us a ride back. They're making fun of my 90s hip hop. They're trying to like tell me about the newer stuff. So since then, I'm still getting like text messages like, all right, you need to listen to this. There's this soundtrack. This, put this into your iTunes. So it was a neat connection. It was a good experience. I definitely got a lot out of the museum that, you know, you typically don't get during like the, you know, Black History Month or stuff like that, going to school, or the stuff you see on TV. That's a completely different experience, definitely a lot deeper. So I was very fortunate to see that. So yeah, and it wouldn't have been the same without having a buddy to do that with. It was a lot more enjoyable.
At the museum, it was interesting, the students actually had kind of an excursion where they had to visit the Emmett Till casket together. So there were opportunities to kind of bring a smile, but then there were also opportunities for seriousness to be able to engage in the reality of the history of African Americans in the United States of America and also abroad. And so Policing Inside Out is not just scratching the surface and looking at the fun things and making everything rosy. We really dig in deep to identify things that are going on, so much so that those individuals in the leadership roles also engaged in a buddy system. And my two buddies are in the front seat here, Deputy Commissioner D'Souza and Lieutenant McGuire. And I want you guys to also share what the buddy system was like for you as well.
You know, I have to echo the thoughts and sentiments that Dan and Doug had to say, and even Aaliyah, that my partner originally was Brianna Carter. We met up there and it was almost the same thing. And the relationship and the building of trust inside the museum was really amazing. I remember about halfway through the tour, a woman comes up to us and says, wow, is that your older brother? And she looked at me like she was getting ready to say no, but really she is my sister, you know? The experiences that we shared that particular day was really amazing, and we're able to carry that over. So it was great. It was great seeing you there. It was great seeing the panel members, the other students and the scholars and the officers really meet up and really connect. And that experience alone, that takeaway alone is worth its weight in gold.
So the museum for me has probably a different reaction every time that I go there. Kiara Thomas was my buddy, and so Kiara is very outgoing, and but you know we were having conversations as we were going through, but I was really kind of at a moment of silence because you know, looking at civil rights, looking at historically what African Americans have really built and had to go through this country is very heart wrenching, and so for me seeing you know, all of those historical factors are really kind of made me silent as I thought through those moments. But at the same time, I think the buddy system had great value because students and officers were able to really take a course walking through the museum, and as they were walking through the museum, really they were walking through history. And so I think that kind of mirrors where we're at today in Policing Inside Out. I think this is a course really where we're currently making history. And so that's really the effect that the museum had upon me.
Thank you, Lieutenant McGuire. And this is a great opportunity to go into viewing some more testimonials.
I appreciate the class. This is the foundation, a start, but just learning that we have so much more work to do. And also realizing that officers are not superheroes. We expect them to be social workers. We expect them to be first aid, medics, psychologists, everything. We call on the police for everything, and just realizing that, yes, they are trained to do a job, but just easing up a little bit, but still also holding them accountable as well.
I would say the most important thing I learned was to not to jump to conclusions when I see a video online or when I read articles on social media, to try to think of situations holistically. It taught me to think about what it would be like if I was an officer, or if I had to wake up and deal with everything that I have in my life going on currently, plus the job and the duty to protect and serve other people.
I think the most important thing I've learned during the program is how to listen. Sometimes we tend to shut down once somebody says something that we don't like, and it takes an extra push to keep listening through your own hurt or your own uncomfortability, because usually that's when you learn something.
Sergeant Gibson, your participation during the first semester was pretty significant. You shared a lot, opened up with the students, was able to really build, you know, trust and also cohesion, not just, you know, engaging in conversations, but really making those conversations and those commitments stick. I'm really interested to hear, you know, what you've been doing, you know, over the last semester, and what nuggets or components of the class were you able to take with you and that you're still using today?
I think one of the main things that I took from the program was, you know, when I was working as an officer on the streets of Baltimore, and we deal with people that are either involved in criminal activity, or at least I assume they were involved in criminal activity, I always expected some degree of fear, for people to be afraid of the police because they were possibly in fact doing something wrong and had a legitimate reason. But what I took from the class is talking to students that, you know, really were not ever involved in any type of criminal activity, that had a genuine fear of the police that was very real to them. And I think that's a component that I didn't completely perceive that was out there. So that's one of the main things I think I've taken from the program that I really think about when I'm out on the street and looking at the way someone may be reacting to an investigation that we're conducting, or just, you know, reacting to our presence on the street.
Was there a transformation for you in the class?
You know, I think there was. I mean, I remember the introductions that we would do, the checking in, and in the very beginning, the disclosure was very guarded. The officers would talk about their shifts and that they were tired. The students would talk about their classes and how hard they were. But toward the end, the officers were talking about, you know, serious illnesses in their families, deaths, you know, serious disclosures about personal things in their lives. And the students did the same thing, you know, as we went on. And that was an indication of communication and the building of trust to have that more deeper disclosure, just in that as a measuring tool to me.
Mm-hmm. Very interesting. I'm interested to hear, you know, from the full panel as we're going into closing out the segment, and any advice that you have for individuals who are residing in communities where there's no trust, there's no cohesion, there's no conversation, there's no commitment, there's no respect. Really, there's nothing. There's kind of that space between. And participating in this class, we know that this is not the have-all, be-all, that this is not going to answer all of the questions, that this is definitely a start and a strong start in the right direction. What have you learned, or what sort of advice would you be able to give to somebody else?
I would personally say that you should be open. You know, I understand firsthand people's hesitation towards the police, but if you want to genuinely mend this broken relationship, you have to be open and you have to want to do that. And so we can't be standoffish. We have to be open to each other and be able to talk to each other and figure out how we're going to move forward.
And do you feel open now?
I'm opening up.
Okay.
I have a little bit of ways to go, but I feel a little bit more open, I should say.
Okay, Sergeant Gibson.
The relationship has been damaged between the community and the police, and it took a long time to get that way. It's going to take a long time to fix it. You know, it's not like a relationship between two people where divorce is an option or separating is an option. There is no option for divorce. There is no option for separation. the community and the police departments have to come together. There's no other outcome.
Cameron.
Deputy Commissioner D'Souza said that students, we tend to view things through a historical lens. And I think that in living memory, the police have existed as an oppressive force in communities. I think that until we're able to come to terms with the reality that police are contractually, by charter, obligated to serve us, we're not going to be able to utilize our full power to reform them. And I think that until we get to that point, it's going to be hard for us to really have any legitimate substantive conversations, but more than that, create any real positive lasting changes on the relationships that we have with our police departments.
And do you think it's important that we do that together?
I think it's not going to happen otherwise. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Sergeant Helton, what about you?
I would say to the people who've gone through the class and the people in the community, don't wait for the police to come out and reach out if they're not already. You all need to come together. If it's something where you want to have a community meeting or just a smaller group, and you invite the police, at least my department, we'll come. Somebody's going to come. Somebody's going to talk. You want to initiate dialogue. If you want it to be informal, if you want to talk about something, have a small presentation, but we'll talk to start establishing something. Because things are going to happen again. Unfortunately, there's going to be other incidents on the news of stuff that's going to happen. And we need to have that dialogue already established, that avenue to where we can go and say, all right, I saw this had happened. What would you all do? What's your all's policy? What do y'all think about this? Can you explain to me what's going on? I think that's important. There's 18,000 different police departments in the country. And when you see something in the news, don't think that's how policing the whole country is. Keep an open mind, because we want to connect with you guys to get your input. That's the only way we're going to solve the problems. We got to do it together. And we need to, both sides need to come together as far as making that initial step if there's no dialogue or communication there.
15 weeks of engaged conversation, buddy systems and visits to the National Museum of African American History and Culture. Also the shoot, don't shoot simulation where students were actually placed on the other side. Ride-alongs in the AM as well as in the PM. And we still have a very long way to go, but at Howard University, we pride ourselves on invigorating new ways of operationalizing the classroom and taking individuals out of their comfort zone in order to understand the realities and identify the real solutions and additional questions to the issues that continue to plague communities of color and also communities all across the globe. I would like to end by going to the final testimonials.
I think the most valuable part of this experience was just the knowledge that I gained and the relationships that I've been able to make, not only with members of the police community, but also with members of my fellow Howard University classmates. I think that those are relationships that are gonna continue after I graduate, after I leave this class, after I go out and work into policy and trying to change some of these aspects of law enforcement that we find detestable.
Seeing a young man or a young lady from Howard University who was afraid of the police at the beginning of the semester or afraid of police in general, and seeing a police officer who didn't know quite how to relate to a young man or a young woman, and them coming together and building together.
I think the most valuable part of Inside Out is just actually being there physically. There's not too many HBCUs that are like actually allowing, African American students to come into the prisons or even have those little conversations that we have now with police officers. We even had a class with juveniles. So I think that experience in itself is unique.
So now we're going to go ahead and start our Q&A, but we're going to start with Mr. Jim Baker. Now, can you give us a little background about yourself, sir?
Thank you. Dr. Muhammad, first of all, thank you for allowing IACP to be involved in this transformational history-making event. I'm the Director of Advocacy at the International Association of Chiefs of Police. I represent the executive team there, and I also represent our nearly 30,000 members in almost 140 different countries. And we are honored and privileged to be part of this this effort. And I have about 40 years in active law enforcement. I ran three different police agencies, and I was the head of a statewide police academy. And I will say that I'm humbled to be in the presence of this dialogue. It's as I've said at the last closing ceremony, I come from white privilege. I don't necessarily, and I didn't necessarily understand the struggles of African Americans through the history of policing in America. And for us at IACP, we stand honored to be part of this process, to change the dialogue. You heard it here from the panelists, to have a better understanding of what our role as law enforcement leaders in this country are to bring public safety to all communities that are served. So that's my background.
Thank you, sir. We appreciate it. Thank you so much. And I believe we have another question.
So my question was, I believe last week was the 2-year anniversary of Freddie Gray's death. What has changed in the Baltimore Police Department? And what does this class do to address the larger picture that, not that police aren't humans or people like us, but that police are obstructing justice to a degree and evading justice to a degree?
We've done a lot, but I really have to go back and say that we were doing a lot prior to. The Baltimore Police Department and the community, we had a great relationship. 99.99% back us every single day. And I say this all the time, I say to Lieutenant McGuire, that although the community does not wear a uniform, they wear the badge and they support us. So we had this incident that occurred with the Freddie Gray, we wish it never happened, but it did. But it really put things in perspective for us to take a look at us. So we took a look at ourselves in the mirror and said, what policies do we have to address? What do we have to change? We adopted the pillars in the 21st century policing. We really embraced the bookends of the pillar, the first one talking about community trust, and the last one talking about officer safety and wellness. We really took a look at implicit bias training within the police department. And one thing that we're really, really proud of that we really hammered home on was the use of force policy that we really, really changed. We changed the framework, and IACP had a lot to do with that. IACP had created a policy nationwide, and we really adopted that. So. Training, and training is what we're doing now.
And can I add to that?
Sure.
I would definitely say that last semester, you know, we took a group of students to the ground zero where everything happened, and we had a corner-side lecture. So not only having students read the consent decree, 165 pages of DOJ, and also understanding Graham versus Connor, which is the use of force, you know, law that governs and dictates this use of force continuum. So not only educating the students, but also bringing them into the spirit of that place and what that actually feels like. And in order to accomplish that, we had to go out and knock on doors of neighbors to get permission to even come out into that community and say, yes, we are a class from Howard University. We're not here for a photo op, but we're here to engage in conversation with the community, with law enforcement, and with students in the class. And we continue to do that in different spaces outside of the neighborhood so that individuals can know and sending the message, it's okay to comfort our own, and it's okay to go out and be of service too. And more importantly, IACP creates policies and practices across the globe and the nation. So having them be a partner inside of the class allows for their eyes, their ears, and ultimately their hands to be able to write some of those policies into place. And so I think that that's a great question, and that was the importance and the impetus behind partnering with the top organization that has the far reach into these places and spaces. And then also utilizing the energy of the students who ultimately will be graduating and working on Capitol Hill and going into those policy avenues and arenas. And so next semester, I am hoping to get more political science students who participate, as well as partnering with Howard University faculty across the campus to be able to delve into that, which is kind of outside of the realm of a criminologist or a sociologist.
Got you. You know, I wanted to ask you about what was the conversation when you maybe presented this program to Dr. Frederick or the board, the school board. What was that like?
It's a very interesting question. It actually came about in kind of a short conversation with our president here at the university. And there were students outside of my door over and over. I couldn't get to have my office hours because there were lines of students who were in tears and crying about the reality of what was going on, and they were frustrated with the administration. They were frustrated with me that we were teaching beyond the realities of what was going on. And when I presented it to our president, completely on board. He said that this is an amazing idea, this is an opportunity, and it should be seized. And I continued on and went with it.
Wow. And you know what? I have another person who just came up here. Can you please give us your name and let us know why you're here today?
So my name is Shivani White. I am not a Howard University student or alumni. I actually went to Towson University, but I currently work at the U.S. Department of Education. And I just thought that this program was amazing. My question to you, Dr. Muhammad, was, or is, have you decided to partner with any other campuses to kind of spread the word and broaden what you guys are doing here in the community?
Thank you for that question. Very excellent and relevant question. Yes, we initially were looking at, you know, a pilot year. You know, you go in that first semester and it's kind of, you're trying to figure everything out and get the pieces going and get the ball rolling. We used an evidence-based practice, and so we learned from that first 15 weeks to go into the next 15 weeks, and now after a year, yes, we are having those conversations about expansion. We are looking at expanding into HBCUs across the nation. Definitely interested in Morgan, definitely interested in UDC, and reaching out to those universities that are really close to where we are. Because Howard University is a part of the consortium, we have access to so many different students that also can apply to the class through the consortium. And so having conversations about holding, you know, 5 seats within a 15 course for individuals to participate outside of the consortium. Definitely interested in other partners, and if you guys have any locations in mind, we're going with that. At the end of this semester, we will be gathering as a team with IACP and all of the leadership that have helped in advancing it to this year to sit down and really sit back and identify clearly what does that look like. So having a 2-day focus group to be able to identify the nuggets and the best practices of what we've identified across a full year, and then ultimately having the wings to fly out there to other institutions.
And you know, what I noticed about this program is that you have faces that maybe people may not know about. You have Black police officers, Hispanic police officers. You have a whole, you know, gamut of different people that actually work within this program. But I wanted to talk to Officer Bonaparte here because I think it's important that people know that Black women police officers do exist.
Absolutely.
And you know, you have, what is it like for you being a Black person and a police officer? What is your day like? Do you still have the same fears that maybe someone like me may have?
Well, I've been in law enforcement for almost 24 years, and to be perfectly honest, I've never had a situation where it was a racial situation. For me, at least I didn't recognize it. For me, it was more or less I dealt with females challenging me more, whether they were white, Black, green, it didn't matter. More females challenging me than men. Okay. I've been in community collaboration division for in and out almost 17 years. Wow. And I've never had a situation where I thought it was racially motivated. It was more or less everything that was going on in the community, you know, it was presented on the news and things of that nature that I had to deal with. They weren't looking at me as being a Black female police officer. They were looking at me just being a police officer, period.
Gotcha. Mm-hmm.
And that was the issue. until they got to know me and until they started talking to me. And me personally, when I walk up to someone, I was always taught, well, we, as coming out the academy, they said, it's not how you encounter them, it's how you leave them. And that stuck with me. So when I walk up to someone, I'm treating them the way that I want to be treated, the way that I want my family to be treated if they engage a police officer, whether it's white, black, green, purple, or blue, it doesn't matter.
Well, that's all we have time for right now. So we want to thank everyone who came out here, especially our panelists and Ms. Muhammad, Dr. Muhammad. Thank you for thinking outside of the box and putting this together. And you know, I have these two people back here, and they're beautiful little girls. Come over here, sweetheart. This program is needed because of this, because of the next generation. So we have to get this right now for these two and all of the other kids out there. So thank you so much for being here, and a special thank you to the folks watching at home. And if you haven't already, stay connected to us by visiting our website, whut.org, or follow us on Twitter at @WHUTTV. I'm Minnie Larry, and I look forward to seeing you all next time.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.
This program is part of the American Graduate Initiative. Let's make it happen.